So I am so pleased that we can gather today. I'm so pleased to see so many people here. I'm sure we would have had more if the weather was a little better, but I can't do, I prayed about the weather, but I can't do anything more than that. But it's lovely that we can meet together. And I don't think we should be taking this for granted, because we haven't been able to do this for ages and we don't know how long we'll be able to continue. Hopefully we'll be able to continue forever, but we don't know. We're still in uncertain times. A particular welcome to Bishop Anna, who is with us sitting at the back there. Very glad that you can come and experience this St. Peter's Church family for the first time. Hopefully this will not be for the last time and we'll be seeing you again before long. So just a quick word about how this service came about. We were looking at the Transforming Futures. There was a parish consultation about that, and there was a desire to have some kind of homecoming service. And then I said, well, do you realise it's our 130th anniversary? It might be a good time to have a homecoming service. And so that's where this whole weekend was born, really. It was that way around. And although this service has changed a little bit, it's becoming more of a service of remembrance and hope. This is the reason that we're here this weekend. And I want to give thanks to everybody who's made this happen. You wouldn't believe the amount of work that's been going on this last week or so. And many of our church people are exhausted. And I think that's stopped them being quite so feisty. They're all tired. I've tired them all out. But there we go. But special mention to those who've prepared the ground, who've built the stage, who've been setting up today and will have to take down tomorrow. The tech team, who've been amazing. Those who are going to contribute memories today. And particularly to Tony Reynolds, who stepped in. I didn't have a very good vision of what this service would look like, and I was floundering. But Tony stepped in, and he took over. And between us, mostly him, but between us, we've kind of formed this service. But his vision and his idea for this was stunning. And really, without him, well, it certainly wouldn't be a service like it is today. So thank you, Tony, for everything you've done. And I'm sure everybody's going to be blessed by your preparations. So to join in today, you should have two pieces of paper. You should have the service sheet, which gives you the outline of what's going to be going on and when, and the journey the service is going to take you on. And you should have a separate sheet with the song words on. So hopefully you've got both of those things. And we're going to open with the praise team. Is that right? Is it praise team? Okay.
Is let your mercy reign. And when I was telling Shirley about that, she said, yes, let's pray for God's mercy and not real rain to come down. So I invite you to stand if you want to, but if you can't, that's okay as well. But it's so nice to be able to say that. Let's stand and worship the Lord together.
Hearted with a song of praise to sing. You reached down and lifted us up. Let your mercy rain on us. Abide is your love, oh God. You're the overflow. You're the fountain of my heart. Let your mercy rain.
Good afternoon. My name is Rob Hutchison, and I'm here to offer the opening prayer. Let us pray. We come before you, O Lord, on this 130th anniversary of the official establishment of this parish of St. Peter's Anglican Church here in Comox. We acknowledge that this ministry in this area started many years before that date. We give you thanks and praise for the work of those who came before us, offering ministry in all its forms. We give thanks to the Robb family for the donation of the land on which the church, hall, and rectory are situated. We give thanks for the past clergy and lay leaders of our church. They have set the example well for us today and for those to come, to be able to offer the ministry you call your followers to carry out to all peoples. You, Lord, have blessed us abundantly, and as time has passed, things have changed in our church. And today we have the first woman to serve as rector of St. Peter's in the person of Reverend Sue Lynn Milne. And we also have the Right Reverend Anna Greenwood Lee serving as our diocesan bishop. Our parish is in partnership with many outreach ministries in this area. We give thanks for their work and seek your continued blessing on their efforts to serve your people. Most merciful Father, we beseech you to send down your blessing upon your church in this parish, that all its members may dwell together in unity and brotherly love. Keep far from us all self-will and discord. Endue your ministers with righteousness and enable them faithfully to dispense your holy word and sacraments, to bring again the outcasts, and to seek the lost. Grant that we may so receive their ministrations and the use of your means of grace, that in all our words and deeds we may seek your glory and the advancement of your kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
We now want to hear words from some who've been here for many, many years, their memories, their insights. Okay, is that better? No. We're having difficulty with the... it's on. Hold it like this. Does that make a difference? All right, I have to be really close. Okay. We have among us people who have been here for over 60 years as members of this parish, and they bring memories and insights that we will all benefit from. So Jonathan and I are going to be taking these mics around to various people in this particular session, and we're going to be beginning with... We're going to begin with Trish McCaffrey, who unfortunately, as you know, many of you know, has been in the hospital and was unable to be here. But Avril Revel is going to be speaking on her behalf.
Peter's has been Trish's church since 1960. Initially, they chose St. Peter's to fit in with golf. That was a good thing. As God knew, Trish would meet her husband there. It has been her church for more than 60 years. Many happy memories include use of the church sailboat, a rapidly growing number of young families, a vibrant Sunday school program which grew to over 100 children in 5 years, picnics at Kin Beach, and Sunday afternoons at St. Peter's Rock with many other families. God was surely there. One of Trish's children asked who was standing beside the priest who was alone at the altar. We experienced a revival, and a number of speakers came to the church, including Jim Glennon on healing and Bishop Tutu. Thursday evening prayer and praise in the hall was crowded and included many others from across the valley. We experienced a wide range of music, accessing many different sources of hymns and songs, and a new organ capable of producing sounds from cathedrals around the world at the press of a button, and Trish played the organ. It enhanced our singing, and other instruments of praise were added. You will forget the first time we sang, "Alleluia, He is coming." Small, agape groups for study were inaugurated, emphasis was placed on the church being the body of Christ, and worship, liturgy, prayer, both personal and communal, and lay ministry were important. Unanimity with reliance on the word was encouraged. These are just some recollections of the impact St. Peter's has made on Trish and her family over the years.
Okay, my name is Helen Dawson, and I am also speaking for my husband Ed because he is not feeling well today, so when I continue, it'll be his little portion. Both Ed and I came back to faith in 1975 when the wind of the Holy Spirit was blowing over this island. I guess you could say we had our Pentecost encounter. We experienced God working in great ways as we witnessed and moved in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We both had church backgrounds, but this was different. Skeptics said we had found religion, but in fact, we found a new relationship with the triune God. So then, having to decide which church to attend, Ed pointed out that as a child, he had attended here at St. Peter's, and his mother still did. So we stepped out in faith and came to St. Peter's, and we've been attending ever since. I must admit, having come from an evangelical background, I had some adjusting to do. In time, this little church grew and flourished as God poured out his Spirit over us. We experienced God's presence, the Spirit's renewal, and Christian community in unexpected and wonderful ways. We've been here for a long time, so we have seen many changes over the years. And to quote Isaiah chapter 40, we have soared on wings like eagles, we have run and not grown weary, we have walked and not fainted, because our hope and strength has always come from the Lord. St. Peter's continues to be a loving Christian community, and in spite of our differences, we're learning how to extend grace to one another and to focus on our love for the Lord. And because of God's great love, I know he will continue to rain down his grace and mercy. Okay, that was mine, and now I'll just share a little bit from Ed. His story, he says, my story is similar to Helen's, but I do go further back in time. Ed was baptized and confirmed here in St. Peter's. And when he was a young boy, he said Comox looked a lot different than it does now. He lived in a house on Comox Avenue where the Bamboo Inn is now. And across from him was a sheep farm, and cows wandered all over the hospital grounds. On Sundays, he said, my sisters and I would walk to church for Sunday school. And even though I was very young, I do have memories of sitting in church when the big earthquake hit the Comox Valley and seeing the lights, which then hung down, swinging back and forth. He said the little church was shaken, but like the house that was built on the rock, it stood firm. Thank you.
I'm reading this for Mary Jean Crouch, who is unfortunately not feeling well today. Neil is over there. Neil and I began our Christian walk at St. Peter's 40 years ago. We had three children then, with a fourth to soon follow. There were dozens of young families then, and about 100 children in Sunday school. Wow. Our friends then are still among our closest friends now. We did everything together with our children, family camps, every sunny Sunday picnics together at what we called St. Peter's Rock in Kai Bay. We shared children to free parents to go to conferences and teachings or getaways. We'd often have 8 or 10 kids around at weekends. We even considered going into community together, buying and building and living on a shared property. What I realize now, but I didn't then, is that we'd become a village. All the women loving each other's children like real aunties, imagining marrying our kids off to each other's, creating a loving, welcoming, safe environment for many homes. Now, 40 years later, we are still very close friends, although living far apart, and our love for each other's children is still profound. It's these women we often go to first to ask for prayer for our kids during tough times, and I certainly hurt when their kids are struggling. I know that if I need something for my kids or my grandkids, there's a good chance that some of those original church family friends will rise to the occasion, as with the Baileys taking our grandson Sam to live with them for a semester last year. It was an instant yes. I'd do anything for their 30 or 40-year-old children. I love to hear how they are doing, and when they have new grandchildren, new jobs, life successes and hiccups, etc. We have a shared history, and I'd like to thank all those friends from many years ago. It indeed took a village to raise all our children, and it was a very healthy one at that.
Hi, I'm Mary Hopwood. The first time I came here, I walked in and Don Harrington attacked me, welcomed me effusively, and introduced me to Betty Wiggerink, and we're still good buddies. I read through the bulletin and participated in the service that day, and every single thing that happened seemed to be something that I would want my church to be involved in. There was L'Arche. At the time, there was also the Alzheimer's Awareness. We don't need that anymore. Pregnancy Care Center, Father Foddy in Palestine, ACTS, Jim Wardrop, the founder, had been our friend, followed by David Moore, Sunshine Lunch Club, Prayer Chain, Youth for Christ, Unity Cupboard, thanks to Joy, Bible studies with Gordon Strain, with his relentless sense of humor, and it just everything seemed to click. I loved covering for Leslie in the church office. Pastor Jim was the best boss, and also Rob, for only a year. And also, I loved helping out in the Unity Cupboard. I met the most wonderful people at every turn. Working in the office, I got to know pretty much everybody in the church, and I still feel so blessed by all of them. They were all involved in caring for others sacrificially and doing things behind the scenes, and I just can't say enough about this place, and I'm blessed by God to be here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm reading this. I'm Shirley, and I'm reading this for Joan Holmes because she wasn't able to be here today. So the term homecoming was not a phrase or cultural experience in Britain when we lived there. You left home. But in coming to Canada, we were quite sure that Canada was to be our home, and so it has been. In moving to a new place, we always looked for a church we could call home regardless of denomination. So it was in moving to Comox. We attended services at several churches, and on this particular day, we were at St. Peter's. During the passing of the peace, the couple in front of us turned around, and it was Norm and Barbara Denmark. We were so surprised, as Norm was as tall as Lee, maybe even a bit taller at 6'7". They were so warm and friendly, so that sealed it. St. Peter's became our spiritual home. A few days later, we went through a very dark time. One of our sons became a full-blown addict, losing everything. At this time, we shared what was happening with our church family, and once or twice a year, we would get a letter from the rector asking if there was anything we would like prayer for. I responded yes and mentioned our son. I got a phone call from Jim Lister, the rector, wanting to visit and pray with us, which he did that same evening. At that time, Jim was recovering from his heart attack. I have never forgotten that and will be forever grateful. Several years later, it was Thanksgiving Sunday, and Irene Gifford Cole was leading worship. The Old Testament reading was from Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 to 19. Though the fig tree do not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. At that very moment, I knew this was a word from God to me. Black as things were, that was not to be the final word. God had his yet. I didn't get to share that, but an hour later at our son's church, I did. Thank you, all our praying friends. Thanks to you, we have had a wonderful homecoming with our prodigal son who has come home to us and to our family. We have one more final homecoming again ahead, and I will not be at all surprised if there we will see Barb and Norm to welcome us.
I'm now going to be reading a message from Brad and Jan Minton. Now, those of us who've been in the church here for some years will remember Brad and Jan very well. They moved some years ago to Sprout Lake, but they have sent this reflection. We arrived at St. Peter's in the fall of 1979 with the desire to have our son baptized. New in town, new job, new home. It seems the right and proper thing to do, go back to church. We encountered this group of people who weren't like any we'd met before. Excited about God, talking about Jesus as a real person, and moving powerfully in the power of the Holy Spirit. They welcomed us in and loved us, introduced us to the living God, to the loving God that we had missed in our youth, a brother in Jesus and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. They loved us into the kingdom through community, faithfully walking with us in our ups and downs of life, answering questions, exploring the word, praying, encouraging us in our gifts. They mentored us and released us to face new challenges in other places. We cannot overstate the gift of St. Peter's community in building our faith. It's been an amazing journey, and we are so grateful for the seeds of faith planted, watered, and nurtured by all of you. When God looks at St. Peter's, he says, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant."
So my task this day is to speak a little bit about acknowledging our past. And I know that Bishop Anna will be speaking about these things, so I hope I don't do too much of an overlap. I'm a really blessed person. I get to start each day with a walk on the beach with a lovely Labrador. And I've discovered that I have something of a thought habit. See if you relate. I tend to ruminate about the past or project into the future, and I can get home and I haven't seen a thing. There's something about our lives that tend to draw us away from the moment. Well, I'm a person who was born in privilege in the twilight years of the British Empire. You've heard me say this before. But about three quarters of a century ago, I learned to swim out at UBC in a marvelous facility, which was called Empire Pool. So that's 1954. And within a year or two, it had been renamed as Memorial Pool. Never learned why. About the same time as I was a child growing up in the church, we were singing songs like Onward Christian Soldiers. And children really just assume whatever values or implications are given them, and they march onward. Well, some decades later, as you've heard spoken about here, with my own small family and our new home church, St. Peter's, that's 40 years ago now, we experienced the thriving community you've been hearing about. Well, for example, we had a series of annual retreats down at Thetis Island at Camp Homewood. And I remember the ferry always stopped at what was called Cooper Island. It's now Penelicut. And here was this very impressive brick building. I had no idea really what it was, and I didn't find out for some period of time. to realize that it, of course, was a residential school. And I'd been teaching in the district for, 10, 15 years at the time. I had never heard of them. It's a bit of embarrassment. But I was really blessed through my whole career teaching at Vanier and then at Highland, knowing so many of the Comox Nation, a wonderful group of people who taught me so much. Well, at that period of time in the early 80s, we had prayer meetings. Thursday nights were quite the affairs. There were some up to 100 people used to come. And there was a bit of a twist in all of this, though, that was very discomforting as time went on, and that was that anybody who had Native heritage was required, suggested, nudged to give up any hint of their Native spirituality so that they could fully experience Christianity as it's supposed to be. Well, we've been talking about this being a beautiful place. And so between the two of those, I need guidance as to what I and our society as a whole really do need to learn about what must have been a very pandemic-like experience for the indigenous peoples of this land. Our forebears inflicted a system some would like to call re-education, but it was more like an attempt at eradication. None of us who have settler roots, and this one is a really tough one, can imagine not knowing what became of our children if they were taken away, never to be seen again. In these times, it's kind of like a few powerful individuals have got our attention, and they affect the way we think, so that the concerns of a compassionate community really have to be worked at to have effect. So I'd like to pass on to you some thoughts of a close friend, Julianne Casmer. She is a just retired United Church minister and former street pastor in Victoria. She shared with my wife and me recently on this subject. Terrible thing, she said. She lost about a friend a month over the years of her vocation. So I paraphrase her words. She says, be involved in conversations that are understandable, safe, effective, without outrage, shame, hopelessness, or the rush to fix that we as the powerful and privileged like to jump to. And she says, probably restraining people from wanting to jump to fix is the biggest task. Practice humility, patience, listening in silence, feeling free to say or ask questions without being accused of being ignorant or racist. Her final comment is, this is not a problem to be solved, but an ongoing part of our lives to be lived within.
So hi, I'm Joy Braithen, and I've been asked to read what I call an honor song by Abigail Echohart Hawk, sorry. She is originally from Alaska, and as Neil said, the bodies of missing children that attended residential school have been found, and she wrote this honor song when they had found the unmarked graves of 215 children. And since then, they're into the thousands. So this is by her. When they buried the children, what they didn't know, they were lovingly embraced by the land, held and cradled in a mother's heart. The trees wept for them. With the wind, they sang morning songs. Their mothers didn't know to sing. Bending branches to touch the earth around them, the Creator cried for them, the tears falling like rain. Mother Earth held them until they could be found. Now our voices sing the morning songs with the trees, the wind, light sacred fire. Ensure they are never, ever forgotten as we sing justice.
Thank you, Neil, and thank you, Joy. 2021 marks not only the 130th anniversary of St. Peter's, but the 150th anniversary of British Columbia as a province. When British Columbia joined Federation in 1871, it's estimated that there were approximately 50,000 people in the province, and historians guess that about 10,000 of them were white. The rest were indigenous or of Chinese descent. But when the first legislature met in 1871, it was entirely made up of white men, and we have transcripts of their meeting. And it says that this is terrible. If we don't do something about this, there could be a Chinese majority in the House or an Indian speaker. And so one of their first acts was to pass a law that Chinese and Indians could not vote. The premier at the time, McCright, refused to pass this into law. He said it was wrong to discriminate on the basis of race. But Prime Minister John A. Macdonald overruled him, and this indeed became law. Our province has a long history of racism. As a diocese, one of the things I'm asking us to do this fall is to study an excellent document out of UVic this year called Ending Racist BC. You can look at it online. It's a quite readable 5-chapter little book you can download for free, and there's some video resources. But the diocese, which takes up all of Vancouver Island and the Gulf Islands, is also going to be facilitating groups later this fall and into 2022, and inviting anybody in the community who's interested in joining with us and learning some of our history to come. As we all know, the church was complicit in the racism of this province and helped perpetuate the genocide of indigenous peoples in this land. One of my predecessors signed an agreement with the government, and this diocese helped run St. Michael's Residential School on Cormorant Island. I traveled to Cormorant Island in May and sat with survivors of that school. I sat this afternoon on the porch here with a survivor of that school. This is not ancient history. These are people who are still amongst us. One of the men I met with in May told me a heartbreaking story of being a very young child who'd been taken to that school. And if you've been to Namgis Nation, the school was up on the hill. It's been torn down. And he remembers being in the school one day and looking out, and his family were fished. And he saw his father's boat coming, and he was so relieved. He thought, my dad's coming to get me. And he saw his dad get out of his boat and walk across and come up to the school. And then about an hour later, he saw his dad go, and his dad get back in the boat, and his dad go off. And he was at that school about 6 more years, and he was so angry with his father that his father hadn't rescued him, or that his father had left without him. And after he left school, he fell into addictions. He didn't see his father for years and years. And eventually he met his father again, and he said, "Dad, why didn't you rescue me?" And his dad just said, "Son, I went to the school and they told me you weren't there." What a terrible thing for a father to carry, and what a terrible thing for a son to carry. It says on the program that I'm going to issue an apology, and I'm not. The Anglican Church apologized for residential schools in 1993. Bishop Logan was present in 1995 when St. Michael's School was demolished, and we put the apology from 1993 on that school. I think the time for apologies is past, and it's time for action. It's time for real acts. The Greek word metanoia, Christians don't really apologize, we repent, right? And the Greek word is metanoia, which means meta, beyond, and nous, which is mind, which basically says it's not enough just to feel bad, right? It's not enough just to feel guilty and awful about this. We actually have to do something. The word metanoia implies a change of heart, a change of consciousness, but more in fact, more importantly, a change of life. And so, yes, I apologize. We all need to apologize for the ways in which we've been complicit in racism, we've been complicit in genocide. But more importantly than that, we need to move beyond that into new actions and new ways of being. And like Neil said, it's not easy to rush into that, or we shouldn't rush into that. We can make a lot of mistakes along the way. But we do need to come into this work with open hearts and with open minds and with open hands and create real relationships of trust. We need to spend more time listening than talking. And we need to learn our own history, because the history of beautiful places like this is wrapped up with the history of colonialism in ways that we are only beginning to understand. And it is part of our journey to recognize our own history in all its beauty, but also in its shadow side. Amen.
If we could stand together for a moment or two, just to acknowledge and remember, if we could do that, please.
my precious list of who's speaking when has slipped from my hands, and you have it. Oh, bless you. Thank you, Vicki. And Vicki, you, in fact, are up next.
You're welcome. Hello, my name is Vicki Boswell. My husband Bruce and I are new to the Comox Valley, but not new to the Christian faith. As we've learned over the years, the four essential ingredients of a Christian walk are Bible study, fellowship, or being with other Christians, living according to Jesus' teachings, prayer, or conversing with God. We chose St. Peter's Church as our spiritual home because we were welcomed unconditionally. We know that this is the place where we can continue to grow in our faith and in turn engage with our community. The St. Peter's vision resonates with us, and we want to reflect Jesus' love in everything that we do here and beyond. God loves all of us, regardless of the prejudices we humans have for one another. Bruce and I are excited to be a part of St. Peter's future of demonstrating what God's love looks like to our community in tangible ways. Thank you.
My name is Jerry Anderson, and my wife Shirley's is right behind me. When we moved to the Valley 21 years ago, we began attending St. Peter's, where we received a very warm welcome, which sounds like what happens here. Shirley joined the choir, and we both joined a small study group, both of which filled needs in our lives. We knew no one apart from our own family in this community, but God blessed us with this church family, which helped us settle in and be at home. In this place, we have had the opportunity to serve and grow spiritually. Over the years, we've been involved in various programs. Shirley loved being part of the leadership for a club for young girls from both the church and the community. And I enjoyed committee work, for example, the upgrading of the sanctuary that I was able to help a little bit with, and helping at study groups. God has used St. Peter's to bless Acts, a BC charity providing clean water and other needs in Uganda for some 50 years almost. Acts grew as its first-time full director, David Moore, and the office were given space in Church House. This parish has prayed for and wonderfully supported Acts for over 20 years. Thanks be to God. It has been an encouragement for us to see God at work in the people here, and we pray and trust that He will continue to guide and bless St. Peter's Comox. The work is not done.
My name is Jocelyn, and I brought my young son here when he was 9 days old, I believe. And I also had a lovely warm welcome, and he's now 27. So I've been here that many years. And when I was asked what St. Peter's means to me, I can't tell you enough about what it means. This is what I wrote. I'm grateful for the connection at St. Peter's, which is ever-changing, shifting as people come and go, seeking, but for the ever-solid foundation of Christ as our firm foundation. For the third chair, and opportunity to invite others to join in and find, learn, and be saved by His grace, mercy, and unconditional love, whether I'm in the church, the forest, at the beach, waiting in emergency for care, strapped into an ambulance, or on my knees, in the darkness overwhelmed. He knows me, He draws near, and He holds me there. And I'm just incredibly blessed to be standing here today because in February, I was not able to stand and having seizures So I'm very grateful. It's been an incredible miracle. And to be part of this family and know that all of you were praying for me was very, I'm very appreciative. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Brian Treen. My personal church journey began as an adult in a huge 100-year-old church, a brick church in a city. It was a wonderful church, even though restoring the vintage pipe organ was a distraction. Then I was a regular at a very small 100-year-old church on Denman Island. What a beautiful community. And we all pulled together to replace the ancient oil furnace with electric heat. Then I ended up at St. Peter's, a medium-sized church, which has been here for 130 years. And it was surprisingly already renovated. So I remember the buildings, the expensive organ, the inadequate heating, but really, that isn't so important. What I really miss is the people. What I enjoy the most about St. Peter's is the people, because that's what a church is. Here we are not just any people, but we are God's people. And this makes me feel very lucky to be here. Thanks.
My name's Ian Oldacre, and when my wife Yvonne and I came here, it was just before COVID, and we knew no one. But we joined and we were welcomed by St. Peter's congregation, and we quickly made some great friends. Alas, COVID slowed activities at the church, but Yvonne and I became sometime readers. I was elected to the parish council, even though few knew me, and I was lifted up by this. This gave me actually a great sense of belonging as well. Thank you, St. Peter's. The church-sponsored walks on Sundays have been a great experience, not only to show us God's wonderful gifts of the rivers and the forests around us, but to be with such great and caring people, for which we again give thanks. Having been a lifelong traditional Anglican, I have been challenged by St. Peter's more, shall we say, modern approach to worship and with contemporary music. However, and although it has sometimes been a challenge, I find the services very meaningful and the sermons' eye-openers into the Bible very interesting and thought-provoking. Thanks be to God.
Hi, I'm Allison Knowles. I can't remember how long I've been coming. 2008, maybe. I've asked people over the years why they've walked into the door at St. Peter's, not right away, after I knew them for a little while, and asked why they stayed. It's amazing how often the answer is that they were searching, and when they walked into St. Peter's, they were home. For me, it was back during a very difficult time for my family. I had a deep desire for a place to kneel down and hand over to a higher power. I wasn't a Christian then, but people at St. Peter's accepted me where I was at. I could be vulnerable. And being in the community, gaining a further understanding of the feeling I had of the healing of the Holy Spirit flowing in me, experiencing the living Word, and the power of prayer, and the mystery of communion, I became a Christian. My kids were raised in this community. I found my place using creativity as a form of praise and community building We did art projects, youth group, girls group, VBC, and more. Congratulations, St. Peter's, on 130 years. And here's to looking forward to the future. Renewed by the Holy Spirit, blessed by God, and walking with Jesus, the Trinity, all that we need.
Well, as you have heard, this place has produced some wonderful experiences for people. And I was thinking about the discomforts, the challenges, the blessings of being a parish family, both what it takes and what it gives. And some months ago, I wrote the following reflection, and it's called An Uncommon Treasure. This is fleeting, seen only rarely, but when observed, wondrous in its worth. A loyalty communal, a set of bonds that hold, a substance substantial, glimpsed, felt, assured. When friends and not so friends merge and become a harmony, a whole, who share their love, who have the other's back to the limit of each one's personhood. A life communal, shared, constant, but veiled, born of willed patience, learned respect, embracing difference, divergent paths, and now lived not as one but as but plural, beyond the bonds of beyond the bounds of family friend, to those embracing the transcendent, loved and shared, uncommon, treasured.
The reading is written in Ephesians. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Unity and maturity in the body of Christ. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, and through all, and in all. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Sister Lynn, it's been quite a day. We started this morning with a walking tour of Comox in the rain, which was quite delightful, actually. And then we ended up at the museum. Have you been over to the museum to see the exhibit about St. Peter's? You should go over. My favorite is the little church dolls somebody made at some point in your history. There's a quite funny looking bishop there with the full regalia and all sorts of funny things. And then Sue Lynn says to me, well, we have a surprise, Bishop. The surprise was a 1927 Chrysler, which was going to transport us from the museum over here so that I could ring the bell at 130 times. But Blair, who was driving the Chrysler, said, well, we've got a bit of extra time. Where would you like to go? So we went down to Goose Spit. We turned around and started to go back up the hill, and the Chrysler stopped working. So we started sliding down the hill in a 1927 Chrysler, and Blair had previously told us the brakes don't work very well in the rain. So I'm thinking, well, this might be the end of Sue Lynn and I as we headed towards the ocean, but eventually the brakes kicked in, and eventually a phone call was made and we were rescued. So I hope if you go down to Goose Spit this evening and you see a 1927 Chrysler, please help the beloved man who is perhaps still there. But bless Sue Lynn for all the creative ways in which she has found to celebrate this anniversary. Despite all the restrictions, I was really hoping we'd be done with masks, as I know we all were, and done with restrictions by September. But here we still are, called to keep each other safe, called to get through what I hope is the last bit of this pandemic. In the fall of 2019, the Sorrento Retreat Center asked me to teach a course in the summer of 2020 with a colleague of mine, Christine, and Christine and I ski together. So we were sitting on a chairlift, and we were like, what are we going to call the course? And I was like, I'm pretty sure the 2020s are going to be weird. And so we called our course the Turbulent 2020s. We had no idea how turbulent the 2020s were going to be. Do you remember the beginning of the 2020s? Australia was on fire. And then COVID, right? And then so many other things. I don't think any of us are going to forget this period of history, right? We'll all know kind of what happened to us in 2020 and now 2021 with COVID. And it really hasn't been easy on church. It hasn't been easy on new rectors who have come and had all but 6 months in a place with people before having to figure out how to do everything the same and different. We're living in what they call liminal time. So liminal spaces, we know that what was is gone, and we know that something else is coming, but we're stuck in the middle. And it's a hard place to be in liminality. It's not quite one thing, it's not quite the other. In liminal time, we often try and rush back to what was, or we try and hurry forward to something else. Neither ever works, right? When we're in liminal space, we just have to hang out in liminal space. The good news is God actually only works with people in liminal space. If you read your Bible, anyone who's not in liminal space, God just goes out of God's way to put them in liminal space. Right? The people would have really liked an express ticket, first class, out of slavery in Egypt into the Promised Land. Right? God's like, yeah, sorry, there's going to be 40 years of liminality right in the middle there, and you're really not going to like it. Right? But that's what the people had to do to really become God's people. Jesus had to spend 40 days in the wilderness. Every biblical story, Elijah, they're all about God putting people into liminal space. Peter kept trying to rush, right, to the next thing and was always in trouble with Jesus, right? I think it's actually a joke when Jesus said to Peter, on this rock I will build my church. I think he was kidding, right? I think he was kind of teasing Peter because Peter was the rock who tried to walk on water and sunk, right? And Jesus had to bring him back. It took Peter a lot of time and liminality before he really arrived. And so here we are in the 2020s in liminality, and here you are celebrating your 130th anniversary, and much of what you're doing is quite rightly looking back at your history, at the time you've had here. But God isn't finished with you yet. Right? And my job as your bishop today is to tell you, let's look forward in faith, right? We're in this liminal space, and it's a little bit uncomfortable, and we'd kind of like it to end, or we'd kind of maybe like to go back to the way things were. And God is working in us, saying, not finished with you yet. God is working in and through you. One of the great things about today's celebration is we're not in the building and we haven't really spent much time talking about it. All your stories are about each other, about people, about God working through you. COVID has not been a blessing, but COVID has helped the church remember that the church is not a building, the church is people. Right? And I get this feeling that you at St. Peter's know that. And when we haven't been able to be in our buildings, I think we've rediscovered the importance of church as people. Of not, we don't go to church, we are church. And that's what COVID has, I hope, reconnected us with. In today's reading from the book to the Ephesians, we heard about being strengthened with power through Christ's Spirit in our inmost beings. We heard about Christ dwelling in our hearts through faith. We heard about being rooted and established in love so that we can grasp how wide, how long, how high, and how deep is the love of Christ. We heard about the love that surpasses all understanding and whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. And so today, yes, we celebrate the past 130 years, but really what we do is we commit ourselves to faithfully walking into the next months, the next years, the next decades, the next century, as faithful servants. Knowing that the one God of all time and all space, the one God who has been faithful to our ancestors and predecessors, will be present and faithful to us no matter what joys and what struggles come. And so to finish today, I share with you a prayer I've borrowed from our Lutheran brothers and sisters, which goes, O God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Tony asked me at this point to talk a little bit about my vision for the future of St. Peter's. What would you say if I told you I don't have one? How can we gain a vision for the future when almost every day things are changing? We're living on shifting sands. I don't know how many of you are familiar with Harry Potter, but in Hogwarts Castle, the staircases move. You might be walking up the staircase and think, I need to get up there now, and they'd suddenly move. And when you got to the top, you'd be somewhere entirely unexpected. That's a bit what it's like at the moment, isn't it? We keep going up and we're not where we thought we'd end up. At our church, we've been going through a process to help us discern God's vision for the future, because it's not my vision for the future that matters, it's God's vision. Because God can see what we can't see. He knows what the church needs to look like to serve him in the pandemic and in the post-pandemic world. Now, there's a book the bishop recommended to us, and it's called How to Lead when You Don't Know Where You're Going. I don't know where I'm going, so it's the book for me. But do any of us feel certain of where we're going? So we have been undergoing this process, and it's been one of holy listening. It's been one of discernment. It hasn't been a consultation. We were quite deliberate about that we weren't going to be asking the parishioners what they wanted. Well, we did, but not at first. We did actually end up doing a survey of people, their views on worship and outreach and ministries. But first, we asked them to lay down any ideas that they had. Instead, we wanted them to try to hear afresh from God. Now, I know some of you here were at a creative evening that we had on Zoom, when we spent time reflecting on various passages of scripture. We spent time listening to worship music together. We had some creative prayer. We thought of lots of ways where we could seek that still, small voice of God. At one point in that evening, I asked people to step outside, to walk away from their screens and step outside of their homes, or if they couldn't go outside, to look out of their windows and just spend some time listening and watching and thinking. And through that, we began to sense what God was saying our church needs to be and what our church needs to do in our community. We called upon the Lord, we waited for him. And we asked for clarity as to where he wanted us to go, not in the far future, but just the next steps. And through this process, something remarkable happened. A consistency arose that we weren't expecting. Something clear emerged. Now, I said at the time, if we came out from that exercise saying the same things as we've been thinking at the beginning, then the exercise would have failed. But that's not what happened. In fact, fresh ideas and strong themes came through it. There was a drive towards outreach, to be in the community for all people. Many of us sensed as we looked out of our window, and I remember standing in front of the house here, looking at the bakery and looking at the tap house and people just passing by and thinking, God just loves them all. And we're here in the middle of this community in such a prime place to reach out and love all people. And I wasn't the only one that had that sense. So from there, we developed a new vision. In fact, I tasked our communications team to come up with a couple of vision statements that we could look at together and choose from. And this vision statement was something that was going to be our guiding light, something that we could align everything that we do with, something to travel by so that we can all move in the same direction together, never forgetting our vision. And the vision statement we chose was this: to reflect the love of Jesus, being caring, inclusive, and just. And I think you've heard today that this has been going on. This is not new. This is something that St. Peter's have done for a long time. But we want to focus on this as our new vision into the future. Because although we don't know where we're going, we don't know where we need to end up. And we don't know what our church or even the society we live in needs to look like in the future. And it could be that COVID, the period of COVID, is going to lead to a huge decrease in numbers in our church. It could lead to growth. We don't know if it's going to draw people to Christ. We don't know if it's going to drive them away. God knows. But we do know the way to our future. We know the way we are going because we know him who is the way and the truth and the life, because the way we are going is the way of Jesus Christ. We know the way as we seek to listen to the Father, just as Jesus did, because the Father's Spirit, promised to us by Jesus, comes and leads us and guides us, and it's on him we fix our gaze. And so we've been on this journey, and we want to continue this journey of seeking and listening and discerning as the sands continue to shift and the stairs continue to lead us to unexpected places. This is a time to place all of our faith in him whom we love, him whom we trust, in him who we follow. So walking with him, it doesn't matter that we don't know where we're going. It doesn't matter what will change in our church. God never changes, but the church constantly does. It always has. It doesn't matter because we are going to end up in the place that he wants us to be, because what we call our church is actually his church. It's his all along. So as we seek to be a church that serves the town of Comox into the future, as we have for the last 130 years, we need to try new things, and then try other new things, and then try something else, building up on those things which God is blessing, and being bold enough to let go of those things that he doesn't bless quite so much. So what is my vision for the future of St. Peter's? To keep our eyes, all of our eyes, fixed on Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life, wherever that might lead. So now I'm going to offer some prayers before our final song. And I'm going to begin with a few words from Psalm 63. O God, you are my God, and earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and weary land. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. So, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your presence in the past, present, and the certainty that you will be with us into the future. You drew the early settlers into a vision to build a church in this place, the first St. Peter's. Through it and because of it, you enabled your work to be done in this town, your people serving and growing and loving and making mistakes. Today, Lord, you draw us on, inspire and challenge us to continue that work, ministering to each other, reaching out to all who live, work and play here. Lord, help us to be a beacon for you even when we are weary. Let us shine brightly. Fill us anew, we pray, so that we can be a place of healing and a place of reconciliation. Lord, right now you are drawing us into a new future. As what has once been is pruned and shaped and sculpted to fit the future that you know your church will need to be ready for. So we pray too for the St. Peter's of the future, for those who will be here to worship and serve and love and mess up and repent and heal and rejoice in the generations to come. Lord, we place all this into your hands with our genuine thanks and our profound love. And I want to conclude with a prayer from Thomas A. Kempis. O Lord Jesus, the brightness of the eternal glory and the consolation of contrite and weary souls, refresh us with the light of your presence. Set our hearts at liberty and let the light of your countenance shine upon our souls. For there is none like you, O God. There is none that can do the wonders that you do. Your word is very good, O Lord. Therefore, your servants love it. Praise and glory be to you, O you eternal Son of the Father. Let our lips and our souls and all that is within us praise and bless your holy name forever and ever. Amen. Before I introduce the final song, I've been asked to remind those who have pre-ordered a meal that those meals are going to be available after the service. Now, it might be there's a few, if you haven't pre-ordered, there might be a few left over as some people are not able to be with us today. I don't know. But those that have pre-ordered, please get your meal first. And I have to say a huge thanks to Church Street Tap House, who have provided the food, and they have decided that they're not going to charge us. Whoa! However, they have suggested that if you still want to make your donation for your food, it can go to us. So I would still encourage you to pay for your food, because St. Peter's would benefit from it. But if you're not able to or you don't want to, then that is fine. The food is free and it's on them. I would also encourage you at this stage, at some point over this next week, it's going to be there for a whole week, to go to the Tap House and enjoy a pint of For Pete's Sake. They have renamed their house beer for us to celebrate with us this week. So for Pete's sake, go and get a beer. There's also a cocktail which is called, is it the Fisherman on the Rocks or something? Mike sent them the ingredient. He told them how to make this cocktail, so they're making it for us. So thank you to the Tap House over there for all of their support for us this weekend. And so on that note, let's rejoice and let's praise the Lord and let's thank God and let's worship him together.
It's so nice to be able to sing together. We couldn't do that inside very easily. And also, we wouldn't have been able to get everybody in because we can only have 60 people inside, and there's been more than 60 people. So it's thank you, everybody, for coming and sitting in the cold. And it's just wonderful. Thanks. This is our last song, and then we can move and go and get something to eat and warm up.
Can we all stand, everyone? Let's stand.
Among the saints, like his
Bless you and keep you. Can we please get warm?